Good morning. Welcome to Bethel Baptist Church this morning, and a welcome to all you out there and they're watching this on the internet this morning. Glad to have you with us. Announcements for this week, as you see up there on the board, if you don't normally get the church list of letters, missionaries, and announcements, please send Pastor Rising a note there to his email address, and he'll get you on the list for getting the prayer letter updates and so on. This week, by the way, don't forget to come back for church tonight at 6 o'clock. This week, prayer and Bible study on Wednesday. Saturday, which was scheduled for Sweet Circle, has been canceled. Well, Saturday hasn't, but the Sweet Circle has been canceled. Saturday, Northeast Fellowship Spring Conference in Breezeport. Looking ahead, May 2nd, Lord's Supper, Deacon Fund Offering in the PM service. Tuesday the 4th, Deacon's Meeting at 7 o'clock. And May 15th, Spring Cleaning. There's a note here if you'd like to participate either that date or some other date with some things you could do. See Ron Capiello to let him know you're coming. Missionary of the Week is Rayleigh May Kennedy. And she's widowed, retired, lives in Tucker, Georgia. Members of the week are George and Catherine Snyder. Welcome as members. Birthday, Rose Vay. No anniversaries for this week. Our prayer list is fairly long. Remember our members more recently, the Koff family, as they have lost David. Or Lori as she recovers from surgery. Margie is not here this morning because she got exposed to COVID. So remember each of these. And if you would like to share the morning's worship service with your friends, it's on YouTube. Go to our website, the church website, and there's a contact there to how to get the YouTube video up, and you can share it with your friends.
Psalm 23 is one of the cherished psalms of most people, especially at a funeral. Even if they don't know anything about the Lord, they hear that, but it's a most cherished truth for Christians who know that the Lord is our shepherd, and a shepherd leads, a shepherd goes before. There's many scriptures that talk about that. Psalm 5, verse 8, David's talking about guidance, needing guidance in the face of enemies. And he says in verse 8, "Lead me, O Lord, in your righteousness because of my enemies. Make your way straight before my face." A lot of other psalms talk about that. And I'm so glad that the Lord leads us, even in times like this, when we may feel like the world is out of control. The Lord is leading us, and he's guiding us. And may we remember that this morning as we go through our opening hymn, "Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah." Let's pray, and we'll ask the Lord to bless our service this morning. Lord, we do thank you for the great truth of Scripture, that you love us. In Christ, we have been set free from the shackles of sin and the guilt of iniquity, and that you have called us your own, and you are leading us by your grace day by day. We ask that you would deepen that truth into our hearts today. As we go through this opening hymn, we ask, Lord, that you would teach us what it means to follow you. As we think about your disciples later in our message, Lord, may we recognize the importance of following our Savior. We ask that you would be glorified in all that we do this morning, we pray. In Christ's name, amen.
Thank you.
For our scripture reading this morning, we will be looking at Psalms chapter 20, or the 20th Psalm. And if you can stand, we would ask you to stand in honor of God's word as his word is read. I got one more page to turn here. The assurance of God's saving work, to the chief musician, a psalm of David. May the Lord answer you in the day of trouble. May the name of the God of Jacob defend you. May he send you help from the sanctuary and strengthen you out of Zion. May he remember all your offerings and accept your burnt sacrifice, Selah. May he grant you according to your heart's desire and fulfill all your purpose. We will rejoice in your salvation. In the name of our God, we will set up our banners. May the Lord fulfill all your petitions. Now I know that the Lord saves his anointed. He will answer him from his holy heaven with saving strength of his right hand. Some trust in chariots and some in horses, but we will remember the name of the Lord our God. They have bowed down and fallen, but we have risen and stand upright. Save, Lord. May the King answer us when we call. May the Lord add a blessing to his word. You may be seated.
Let's pray together. Lord, what a wonderful privilege it is to meet together and to fellowship and to worship you, our great God, the one who made us, the one who gave to us the credentials to come before you in Christ, made us fit to come into your presence, not needing a human priest and an offering that we would give, the blood to be shed, but looking back and at the blood of Jesus Christ that allowed us to come into your presence. Lord, thank you for that. Help us, Lord, as we come before you to remember that you are a holy and powerful God. You are not someone that we are to flippantly enter into conversation, but to do it reverently and with great respect. Help us, Lord, when we use your name, Lord, to do it with great reverence and honor. Thank you, Lord, that we can call your name, that we can address you not only as God, but as Abba, Father, as our Father, because of the work of Christ. We thank you so much, Lord, for that day that you opened our eyes to see the truth of Scripture, the gospel record that was presented to us, the work of Christ, his shed blood, that he took upon himself our sin, that he suffered in our place, that he died, was buried, and rose again. We thank you that we have a risen Savior. Thank you that we are also looking forward to the day when we will meet our Lord in the air, should his coming tarry before we pass away. But Lord, if we do pass before that time, remind us that we will be raised again, that the promise of resurrection is rooted in the first fruits of Jesus Christ, the one who rose first. And Lord, what a day of rejoicing that was when he came forth from the grave, and what a day of rejoicing it will be when you call us out of the grave to be with you for eternity with our Savior. Lord, we have friends and family who do not believe these things, and we just ask, Lord, that you would work in their hearts, that you would allow us to be a testimony in their life of the truth that there is a day coming when we will have to give an account, but that day of judgment will be unnecessary in one sense because it would be it has been put upon Jesus Christ, and the judgment that we as believers face is different. It's not for life or death. It's for reward of the work of service that we have done in the name of Jesus. Lord, I pray that you would prepare us. May they hear the truth of the gospel and be saved. May they respond in faith. Draw them to yourself, Lord, we ask. Lord, we thank you for your church, both here locally at Bethel Baptist Church and across the world. We know that many time zones, assemblies have already met, and some will yet meet later today. We just ask for your church worldwide to exalt the name of Jesus Christ. May we as Christians be courageous to name ourselves as those who follow our Savior. We know the world does not like that, is hostile toward it. And we see that increasing more and more, even in our own country. We thank you still for the freedom to be able to worship as we see the scriptures implore us. We ask for consistency and faithfulness in our lives, Lord, as you've given to us so many blessings. We think of our homes, we think of our resources, we think of our friends and family, we think of our jobs, all the things that we have around us, Lord. You have so beautifully provided for our needs. Help us, Lord, not to complain or to grumble as we might at times. Help us to be joyful and to rejoice in all that you've done for us. May our lives and our lips give evidence to others that we have been saved. We have been bought with a price, and we are not our own. Lord, we lift up to you many people throughout the week who are going through difficult times in our church. We think of all the different names in our family here, those who are attending, Lord. You know those needs. You know the joys and the heartaches, and the times of rejoicing and the times of sorrow. Lord, we ask for your help with those who are going through very, very difficult times. We ask for your hand of protection, Lord, as many are dealing with or trying to avoid this pandemic, Lord. We ask for your patience in our lives to be able to sustain ourselves during this as it affects everything we do. But give us an opportunity as a witness for Christ in all of this. We pray, Lord, for our missionary families. We are thankful to have one with us last Sunday night, and we pray that you would bless each of our missionary family and their lives and the needs of their families and their individual lives. Lord, bless their ministries, bless all that they do. We pray that you would help them also to have opportunities day after day to be a witness for the Lord Jesus Christ. We pray for our country, Lord. We pray for our leaders, as you've called us to pray. We ask that you would give them your wisdom. May they hear it and heed it and follow it. And we pray, Lord, that our leaders do not know Christ as Savior, that they would come to know Jesus as the one who alone can give them life. And the most important standing they could ever have is to be named a child of God. Lord, you have blessed us with so many things, and we want to give you glory and worship today from our hearts, from a heart of gratitude. Be pleased, Lord, in all that continues to take place in the service. May it bring glory and honor to Jesus Christ and yourself by the power of the Spirit, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
wish that I could rewrite history. I used to dream that each mistake could be erased. Then I could just pretend I never knew the me back then. I used to pray that you would take this shame away, hide all the evidence of who I've been. But it's the memory of the place you brought me from that keeps me on my knees. And even though I'm free, heal the wound but leave the scar, a reminder of how merciful you are. I am broken, torn apart. Take the pieces of this heart and heal the wound but leave the scar. I have not lived a life that boasts of anything, and I don't take pride in what I bring. But I'll build an altar with the rubble that you found me in, and every stone will sing of what you have redeemed. Heal the wound, but leave the scar, a reminder of how merciful you are. I am broken, torn apart. Take the pieces of this heart and heal the wound, but leave the scar. Everything you've done for me,
don't let me forget.
The beauty in the suffering. Heal the wound but leave the scar, a reminder of how merciful you are. I am broken, torn apart. Take the pieces of this heart. Heal the wound, but leave the scar. A reminder of how merciful you are. I am broken, torn apart. Take the pieces of this heart and heal the wound, but leave the scar. Leave the scar.
All right, I invite you to take your Bibles and turn with me to John chapter 6. We'll be finishing out this interaction that the Lord is having with these disciples, these who have come after the Lord looking for bread. This actually comes after that, and we'll see this morning him interact with two groups of people, the disciples and the 12, and I'll explain that as we get into the text. So, Jesus has spent much time there explaining to these Galilean Jews what it means for him to be the bread of life. He is the one who came down from heaven, and he's been explaining this continually for those who were there. Jesus used quite graphical language, as we saw last time, as we heard him speak about the need to feed on him. No doubt that language was a shock to those Jews as they heard him speak in that way, but the Lord knew their hearts very well. He understood who he was talking to. And he knew that they did not believe what he was saying. They viewed him simply as Mary and Joseph's kid. But he was none other than the Creator, God from heaven. So their eyes were blinded, and the difficult teaching just kind of passed them by. And that's often what happens in our day as well. The Word of God can come to you. You can hear it, and you receive it with joy, while someone else can hear it, and it just, it's as like, it was the news, it doesn't lodge in their brain, their minds and their hearts. Well, their eyes are blinded. Well, this morning, we want to see two different discussions and how the Lord follows up on what he's been saying and how he addresses the 12, or secondly, but first of all, his disciples. So, we'll see the distinction that we see in those two groups this morning. And then as we conclude today, we'll conclude with two important points I think are very practical applications for our lives. So let's pray, and then we'll get into the text together. Thank you, Lord, for your word. Thank you for our time this morning that we have before us. We pray that you would take your word, enlighten our eyes and hearts. May we receive it with joy and respond appropriately. I pray, Lord, if there are any who never come to know Christ as Savior, never confess him as their Lord, that you would open their hearts to the truth, that they would respond in faith and confess the Lord Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of their lives. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. All right, let's look at verse 60. Thinking about all the things Jesus has been saying and those who have been kind of observing him, notice now the response in verse 60, where first of all we see that many disciples grumble at Jesus' teaching. Verse 60, therefore many of his disciples, when they heard this, said, "This is a hard saying. Who can understand it?" Walter Kaiser Jr., he's an Old Testament theologian, he's written a couple books with that in the title, Hard Sayings of the Old Testament, 1 and 2. I was at a lecture once when he was presenting something, on the book of Isaiah, and somebody asked him if he had, what he thinks of the New Testament. You know, it's an Old Testament joke, probably George can relate. He said, well, I like it, I've read it, I like the New Testament. I mean, that is sort of a joke. Obviously, he knew it very well, much better than the questioner, but if he were to write a book on what Jesus said in the New Testament, Walter Kaiser probably would have included this in his hard sayings as one of the chapters. It's a hard saying. Now, we see here many of Jesus' disciples, after they heard Jesus expound in the synagogue what it meant that he was the bread of life and why they needed to feed on him, they concluded that this was a hard saying. So that singular this refers to, I think, everything Jesus has been saying. This is a hard saying. Now, their reaction may have been similar to ours. I mean, when you first read that in your life, and even as you study it more, it is a hard saying to eat his flesh, drink his blood. I mean, that's difficult to hear, but to even think about that. Well, John records here that many of Jesus' disciples responded to his words with a continued lack of comprehension. Now, before we get too far, who are these disciples? We use that term to describe the people that Jesus had individually called who were kind of in an apprenticeship with him. But I think based on verses 66 and 67, that this is distinct. These disciples are distinct from the 12. So these are those who are following Jesus in a sense. So there's a distinction between the disciples and the 12. And I think there's also a distinction between those who are his disciples and then those who are really his disciples. Remember in John chapter 2, after Jesus had, he was in the temple, the response was that many believed what had taken place. But the Lord said he didn't commit himself to them because he knew it was in their heart. And I think the lesson there is that there are those who believe, and then there are those who truly believe. So it sounds like a distinction without a difference, but there really is a difference. And that's the whole point to me as I see this message, that true, genuine faith in the Lord Jesus Christ will not stop at some point. It will continue. So many of the Galileans, they were eager to follow Jesus in a way. They were around him. They were listening to what he was saying. He was certainly intriguing. He was doing many things that were interesting. He was giving handouts. I mean, who wouldn't be interested in one sense in what this person's doing? So many of those attached themselves maybe in a more specific way, and they were considered his disciples. They wanted to follow him wherever he went. Okay. So think about this. So that's who we're dealing with here, those who are attached to him in some way. But, of course, what we'll find out is that when things heat up, they kind of step away. So a hard saying is just that. It's something that's hard to understand. It's something hard to grasp. What Jesus has been teaching here are biblical teachings that require spiritual insight. The Spirit of God must give us an understanding. We can try to explain it all day long, but unless God gives us an understanding in our hearts, we just won't grasp it. Now, it's interesting. Their statement here says, who can understand it, as I read in the New King James? It's literally, who is able to hear it? Some of your Bibles, maybe the English Standard brings that out. Who can hear this, right? It's even hard to hear it, but let alone comprehend it. It can be off-putting as you hear and think about what Jesus said. So they grumble. These disciples, it's a hard thing. Well, what does Jesus say to that? Notice in verses 61 to 65, the Lord responds. Point number two. Let me read 61 to 65, and then we'll break it down. When Jesus knew in himself that his disciples complained about this, he said to them, does this offend you? What then if you should see the Son of Man ascend where he was before? It is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh profits nothing. The words that I speak to you are spirit, and they are life. But there are some of you who do not believe. For Jesus knew from the beginning who they were who did not believe and who would betray him. And he said, therefore, I have said to you that no one can come to me unless it has been granted to him by my Father. So Jesus knew their hearts. He knew who was not able to understand what he was saying. Jesus draws out that by his response here. Jesus says in verse 61, he knew in himself. That speaks to his sovereign will, his sovereign knowledge, I should say. He understood more than just someone who has a hunch, right? We might think we know something when, you know, we really don't, but we just think we do. But Jesus really did. He knew in himself that they were complaining about this. He knew their unbelief. So without one word, Jesus knew what they were thinking, and he responded accordingly. He does that frequently. Why did this crowd initially come to him? They wanted more bread. Jesus told them first. It's a little like Daniel, right? Nebuchadnezzar. Well, tell me the dream. Wow. Tell me the dream and the interpretation. Well, no one else could do that, but God gave him insight to do that. Well, so without one word, Jesus responded. And he says, does this offend you? You know, what comes to mind when you read that? It's, you know, we're living in a world that is offended about just about everything. And, you know, we're trying to be super careful about things, and you know, every time we see the news or read, there's some new layer of insanity that just seems like, really? I mean, I read the other day, maybe you saw this, that apparently some font choices are considered offensive to some people. I think we're sometimes inventing things to be outraged, but Jesus knew their hearts, and he, even though he asked the question, he realized that they were offended. Jesus has asserted much about himself that they do not accept. Are you offended by this, he says. Literally, it's the idea, are you scandalized by this? This is the word from which we get the word scandal in English, right? Jesus is considered a scandal in one sense. He's an offense. You have to go through Jesus Christ to get to the Father. And, of course, that takes the drawing of God to do that. Well, can you imagine the headlines in that day? What people would put out based on what they saw or thought Jesus was doing or saying? It would be interesting. But word travels so fast in our day that it's hardly even analyzed before it's put out there. But I think word traveled pretty quickly in that day, too. People seemed to know and follow Jesus kind of wherever he went. And word got around. Well, it seems that these disciples are now recognizing something important or maybe detrimental to their lives, that somehow attaching themselves to this Jesus is becoming a bit uncomfortable. He's starting to say things that are hard, and we don't quite get it. We don't really like it, if you will. Jesus was a fascinating person to follow when the stakes were not that high. But now Jesus was speaking about giving his flesh for the life of the world in that graphic language. Now, did they begin to understand that that's a language of death? That's the language that's really pointing toward where Jesus is going? When you begin to understand what following Jesus means, personal sacrifice, embarrassment, whatever that might be, that's when people start to peel off. And that's what we see here. Now, notice what Jesus says in verse 62 about their being offended. What then, if you should see the Son of Man ascend where he was before? You have to think about that for a second, but he's saying, what if you saw me go back to heaven where I was before? How would that affect your thinking? Now, remember, that was the issue. Back in earlier part of chapter 6, I think in verse 42, he said they didn't like the fact that, you know, this is just Joseph's kid. You know, how is it you have said, I have come down from heaven? Well, what Jesus is saying, well, what if I went back to heaven? What if you saw me do that? What would you think? I mean, that would be astounding, right? I mean, so Jesus jumps right back into the details and asks them that hard question. Now, John has taught us in this chapter that Jesus was with the Father. That's how the gospel begins. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was sent to this earth. He took upon flesh. We know that theologically. John has laid it out. But this is unfolding in real time. Jesus is speaking to some people who are following him, and they're not totally grasping it. So this scandal of what Jesus is beginning to say will become heightened as well when Jesus goes to the cross. He's the ultimate failure, right? He didn't accomplish what we thought he would. He didn't set us free from Rome. He didn't, with a strong hand, push away those who were ruling over them. It was a scandal in their mind, and that would be the height of it. So these disciples do not answer Jesus, but Jesus continues to speak. And now notice in verse 63, he makes another important point. It is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh profits nothing. The words that I speak to you are spirit, and they are life. Jesus here makes an important point that has been the assumption in all of this chapter. Jesus has been explaining the deep truths that only God the Spirit can help us to understand through his illuminating ministry. Only God's Spirit can give life. This is what Jesus talked to Nicodemus about. How can you be born again? How can you go back into your mother's womb? No, you must be born of the Spirit. It takes spiritual life. That's a work of God. Unless a person is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. John 3, verse 6, that which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. If you've been born by the Spirit, you have spiritual life. That's what Jesus is talking about. It is the Spirit who gives life. And that the flesh profits nothing. You know, that's a little phrase you ought to circle in your mind or in your Bible. That's the tendency of our natural self. We want to rely on the flesh. You know, God's given each one of you talents and abilities, maybe that exceed somebody else's around you. And God, those are wonderful assets that God has given to us. But that's not why you're where you are today. We don't stand before God because of the great skills that God has put into our life, or whatever effort or efficiency or all the things that define your uniqueness. It's not that. It's the Spirit. Mere intellect will not comprehend the things of God. In this matter, the flesh does not provide assistance. Human nature is of no help in comprehending the spiritual truths of God. This is why when we speak to unbelievers about spiritual truths, unless God the Spirit works through His Word, there's going to be a blank stare or a pushback. And we've all seen that. But that doesn't mean what we say or that God is not active. He does what He does, and we depend upon Him. But natural ability will not make the matter better. Now, certainly, if you look at the Apostle Paul and you look at what the exhortations of Scripture, of course, we work hard. We preach. I prepare for my sermons. You prepare for your Sunday school lessons. Whatever you do, you put yourself into it. You put the strength that God has given you. But ultimately, it's a work of God that He brings about His will. So, you know, some of the smartest people we might know don't accept and believe and follow the Lord Jesus Christ. That's an illustration. The flesh profits nothing. It takes the Spirit. We depend upon Him. And Jesus says, the words that I speak to you are spirit and life. I mean, what a blessing it would have been to be around Jesus during His earthly ministry and to hear Him speak truth and life. That's what he's talking about. One writer summarized it well. It says, if the words of Jesus in this discourse are rightly grasped, then instead of rejecting Jesus, people will see him as the bread from heaven, the one who gives his flesh for the life of the world, the one who alone provides eternal life, and they will receive him and believe in him. Taste eternal life even now and enjoy the promise that he will raise them up on the last day. That just summarizes what Jesus has been saying. To feed on Christ is to believe, to hear his word and receive it. Our spiritual life on earth depends upon the word of God, right? What did Moses say? Man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. We need what God has to say. Peter says we are to desire the spiritual word, the milk of the word, that we might grow. If you're stunted in your spiritual growth, it's because you don't have enough input of the word of God. Read the word of God daily. Read it at the beginning of the day, at the end of the day, whenever you're awake and alert and need it, which is anytime. That's when you can meditate upon it. Feed on the Word of God. Listen to what He has to say. I've seen God work in my heart, take a very discouraged person in about 5 minutes reading a psalm to you're a totally different person because you've been feeding on the Word of God. If you feed on the news constantly and try to keep up with everything or, you know, take in all the the teaching of the television and whatever it might be, that's going to have an effect on you if you don't have the Word of God, if you don't have the truth. You're going to starve spiritually, and you're going to feed the flesh, and that's not going to be a good thing as a follower of Jesus Christ. Jesus says that my words are spirit and they are life. My words, your words, they can be wrong. They can be misguided. They can be hollow. They can be any, but God's word is always truth. God's word is always right. Look at what Jesus says. He says, he knew them in verse 64, and he says, but there are some of you who do not believe. Jesus is looking at those who are called his disciples, and he says, some of you don't believe. He knew them. This Son of Man, this great rabbi, this miracle worker, he knew them, and he told them the truth. He said, I know some of you do not believe. They might have thought they believed. Well, we've seen you. We've been around you. We think you've done some, but that's not believing in him. That's not following him. That's not receiving him and recognizing who this Jesus ultimately is. So John the author, notice the comment he adds here at the latter part of verse 64. Remember, John's gospel was written after the resurrection, after these things took place. So you get that insight from time to time. Here it is. For Jesus knew from the beginning who they were who did not believe and who would betray him. Wouldn't you like to have that kind of pre-knowledge, right? But Jesus knew right from the heart, right from the start, the condition of those around him. He knew who would follow and he knew who would betray him. Now notice how he wraps up this response in verse 65. And he said, therefore I have said to you that no one can come to me unless it has been granted to him by my Father. This is the third time Jesus has said that basic truth. Back in verse 37, he said, all that the Father gives me will come to me. In verse 44, he said, no one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him. And here he says it again. He says, I've told you this. This is why only those whom God the Father draws will come. So he's saying something that can be hard. And this is kind of a hard saying in our day. And sometimes we debate it, and I'm not going to do that. But I think the Lord is clear here. The Lord has to work in our hearts to draw us, to give us an understanding of who Jesus is, to bring us to a point of faith and trust. And so what did they think of what Jesus had to say here? They grumbled, and he gives them these theology lessons. Look at verse 66, sad verse. From that time, many of his disciples went back and walked with him no more. That's a sad verse to read. This was the end of the journey for some. They thought they were really Jesus' disciples, that they were going to follow him. But Jesus is starting to get complicated. It's getting a little too much, and some went back and no more. How sad. Jesus' disciples walk with him no more. Many can claim to know, but who will be left standing in the end? Well, we've seen that in our time too. Think about the response of life when things get difficult. As you name yourself a follower of Jesus Christ and you begin to get criticism, you begin to get pushback, it begins to affect your employment or it begins to affect things that are important. What do we do? I think of James chapter 1. A Christian, a true follower of Jesus Christ, can look at trials and consider them joy. That's not madness. That's not sticking our head in the sand and telling ourselves a fairy tale. That's literally true. We can look at the difficulties that God allows into our life and see them as his grace, his allowance. Why? Because God takes that trial and he builds into our life what we lack. How many times can, I know many, many of you could stand up right now and say, you know what, I could tell you about X, Y, Z. This was a difficult time in my life, but look what God did here and the steps that he led me to this point right here. That's how God works. You know, we're living in a crazy world right now. God is infinitely ahead of us. He knows all about that. And he's not pulling a trick on us. He is leading us at every step of the way. He's testing us. He's proving to us our faith. You know, if you have a company and you make little widgets or you try to sell something, you're going to test those things, hopefully, right, before you put them on the market. You don't want the market to say these things don't work, and then you go out of business. Well, that's absurd, right? Well, God tests us. He gives to us illustrations. He gives to us opportunities. That's the way you have to look at it, to prove the genuineness of our faith and to deepen that faith. That's why what a joy it is to talk with saints of the Lord who are senior saints, who walk with the Lord for years, and they just take the trials of life in rhythm. Is it because of their personality? It's because of what God has taught them over the years. Oh, we'll get through this. This is just the way it is right now. God's at work. God hasn't left his throne. God hasn't abandoned his people. He's actively involved in our lives. That spiritual insight that we gain as God leads us and directs us. So sadly, many of those disciples didn't believe, and that was the end of the rope. Enough of that. Jesus, he's getting too religious now, whatever we would say in our day. Well, notice now the second crowd. This is the fourth point if you're taking notes, but notice now the Lord is going to talk to his 12. Look at verse 67. Jesus addresses the 12. Then Jesus said to the 12, "Do you also want to go away?" You can almost see the Lord shifting now to those who were closest to him and say, well, what about you? Are you going to do the same thing? That would have been a stunning thing to hear. The language of this question could be brought out like this. Surely you don't want to go away, do you? Obviously, the Lord is not wondering about their answer, but he's probing them to see what they'll say, to show themselves what they think and how they would respond. Jesus had called those 12 to himself. They had been learning much. The road to Calvary that they were beginning to understand a little was getting difficult. It will get more difficult. But here he probes them. Are you going to go away too? Now notice Peter. Peter's going to say something. Peter often has something to say. And notice what he has to say here. Point number 5, Peter's confession, verses 68 and 69. But Simon Peter answered him, "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Also, we have come to believe and know that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Count on Peter, right? Awkward Peter. Always has something to say, but we're glad he has something to say, even though, we have to put up with the rest of it. Now, Peter, of course, he stumbles. He has his problems. He's going to have more problems than what he does as he gets closer to the cross. But Peter recognizes the foolishness of abandoning Jesus at this point. He admits rightly, he says, there's no one else to follow. You are the one. You are the one giving life-giving words. You are the one who can give us life. Where else will we go? So he's saying the right thing. Even with their spiritual immaturity that we will see come out later in time, Peter and the others confess the truth. He says what's right. It kind of reminds me when I was a first preaching. I'm sure I said things in the pulpit that I didn't really understand, but I probably understand them a little bit more, but still there's the idea that I know I'm saying the truth, but I haven't fully understood it all. And, You know, maybe you've seen that as well. As you get older in life and you get closer to, you know, the end of your life, you can look back and by experience draw from that. But you also know the truth, and you can speak the truth at no matter what point in your life. They had come to realize and recognize who this Jesus was. You are the one that we want to hear, but then he says the theological truth that you are the Christ, the Messiah. You're the Son of the living God. Now, this reminds us of what we'll hear later on, right? When Peter will confess. When we think of that in Matthew chapter 16. And what did the Lord say about that? The Lord says, you didn't come to that position by your intellect, Peter. You came to that because the Father in heaven revealed it to you. And that's exactly what Jesus has been saying here. The flesh is of no help. God will give the truth by his Spirit through the work of the Son and the Word of God. So flesh and blood does not grasp spiritual truth. It needs to be illuminated by the ministry of the Spirit. So Peter has confessed rightly. No, we're not going to go away. We know who you are, and you are the one that we will follow. Now notice what the Lord says here in verses 70 and 71. Notice how he, point number five, he chose the 12. Look what he says. Jesus answered them, did I not choose you, the 12? And one of you is a devil? He spoke of Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon, for it was he who would betray him, being one of the 12. Now again, this is another insight to when John wrote this. It was later in time. He could add that insight. But at this time, they didn't understand that. They didn't know that. So all they heard was, I've chosen you, and one of you is a devil. Now, that would have been interesting to hear. What? Jesus spoke about the 12. He says, I have chosen you. It would be in the upper room in John 13 where Judas will be revealed, but we don't know that yet. They don't know that yet. All we hear here is Jesus says, I chose you. I asserted myself in your life. You were going about your business, doing your thing, and I said, follow me. I'll make you fishers of men. And they followed him. But he says, one of you is a devil. One of you is a slanderer. That's really what the word means. The idea of, now when we think of devil, we think of a lot of things, right? We think of the hockey team that's leaving town, right? We think of the vacuum cleaner or whatever it might be. But a devil is a slanderer. It's a name that's attached to Satan. Jesus was tempted in the wilderness by the devil who tried to twist the scriptures. But that didn't work out, right? Jesus confronted him. Later in chapter 8, Jesus will identify those who are opposing him. And he'll say, you are of your father, the devil. Well, the devil is a murderer. He's one who doesn't stand for the truth. He's a liar. He's the father of lies. So Jesus said, one of you is a devil. And that's what that word means. You're going to oppose me completely. Now, we must think, well, why in the world did Jesus pick Judas? I've heard that debate. He did. And what did God do with Judas? What did Judas do? Judas betrayed him, and that led Jesus to the cross. So you can stand back and say, I don't understand all that, but God's choosing of Judas was part of his plan. What if Jesus never went to the cross, right? That's when you get into these debates. Well, I don't get into those debates because it's all theoretical. Let's just look at what Scripture says. He chose the 12, and one of them is a devil, and that would be Judas. And God used him to bring about his demise, which was the very thing he was talking about, eternal life, the resurrection that would be based on his death, burial, and resurrection. I've often said that when we get into these debates about, you know, theology, just look at Christ. Look at the contradictions that were in place to bring about what we glory in when we preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's where our conversation should go, not to try to win an argument, to make our point, but to glory in Christ. And that's the best thing to me to respond to. So Jesus has said, I chose you, and one of you is a devil. And of course, that would be Judas. And that's it. That's the end of his conversation. We'll pick up here next time. But let me leave you with two important points as you think about this chapter, namely what we've looked at this morning. Number one, genuine faith in Jesus Christ endures. It will last. That is a critical point to recognize. Many of Jesus' quote-unquote disciples appeared for a time to follow him, but they fell away. Things got difficult, and they weren't going to do it anymore. That's a sad truth. When Jesus began to probe the truth before them, he spoke about many difficult days to come. And that's what he was hinting at, and that's when the separation took place. Many disciples departed, but what about the 12? Well, we know that one would depart, but Peter, speaking for the others, said, "We know who you are." And even with Peter's denial, the Lord still was gracious. When we get to the end of the book of John, we see the grace of the Lord in restoring Peter. And we see him shine in the book of Acts as an apostle preaching the gospel. You know, every time I read and think through that whole, the life of Peter, I'm encouraged that God used him and can use us. Now, we hope we don't have to deny him like that, but we know the Lord in his grace and his mercy. True faith in Christ will endure. Doesn't mean it's perfect. You look at Moses. Was Moses a believer in the Lord? Of course he was, but he failed, and he missed out on the promised land. But we'll see him in heaven, and that's a great joy. Because the gospel must be believed through the work of the Spirit, number two, and this is important, pray continually for God to open hearts and minds to the truth about the gospel, about Jesus Christ. The most important element of your and my witness for the Lord Jesus Christ is prayer. Why? Jesus said three times, unless the Father draws, you can't come. You will not come. But all who will come will not be let go. It's sort of a logical problem in our minds, but pray that God would take the word of God, the truth, and open minds and hearts. That's the best thing we can do. We pray, Lord, open the minds of those who are blinded, that they will see the truth. That we think, well, they're smart people, they'll get this. That's not what it's about. It's about presenting the truth and saying, Lord, open their hearts. Our task as a church, as we get to the end of Matthew 28, is to make disciples of Jesus Christ. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel. That's the word mathetuo, which means to make disciples. Make disciples by going, by baptizing, by teaching, by being involved in those things that God has given to us. And we pray that God would take the lessons of Sunday school that you prepare, the interactions that you have with your friends, and that God would take that and give them eyes to see and a heart to believe. There's so much to learn in the Gospel of John, and I trust as we continue forward that God would open our eyes to the truth, to see this one Jesus whom we love, the one who has gone before us, who will head to that cross, who lives and will come one day for us. May we rejoice in our Savior. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for the words of Jesus that we've seen today, the teaching that he gave to these disciples and then to his 12. I pray, Lord, that as followers of Jesus Christ in our day, Lord, that you would give us courage, that you would help us to follow our Savior no matter what. Lord, take away the temptation in our conversations to downplay the truth of Scripture or to hide who we truly are. I pray, Lord, that we will not be ashamed of the Lord Jesus Christ, and that you would give us the strength that we need to take our stand in difficult days. Lord, we know difficulty is coming. We know that that Satan is not pleased when the word of God goes forth and people follow our Savior. But we know in the end that he will ultimately be defeated, as he is already defeated. Give us strength, Lord, as we continue to walk and follow our Savior. And we commit our lives once again to you, we pray in Christ's name. Amen. May we stand together as we are dismissed this morning. Lord, thank you for the truth about our Savior Jesus Christ that we have come to know and love. Lord, thank you for our Savior and what he did for us. I pray that you would take us now out into the world as we live our faith before others, that we would point by our actions and our attitudes to the one who has redeemed us. Thank you for that great work in our lives. We ask that you would lead us, Lord, continue to protect us, give us the strength we need every moment of the day that we might serve you. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen.